bubble. We will have other bubbles.
We'll have other bubbles. I'll guarantee you.
Are we going to go back to the same kind of leverage?
Not for a while. We learn lessons, and they last for a while. And the deeper the wounds, to some extent, the longer they last. I was a beneficiary of that. I mean, I got out of school in 1951, and all my competitors were still worried about the Great Depression, and I had my memory wasn't good enough, so I had forgotten. This will have an impact on thinking for quite a while in certain respects. But fear, greed, folly.
Not going to change.
We haven't got rid of those. We get smarter in all kinds of ways. We don't get smarter emotionally.
Why is that?
It's just the way the human animal is put together. Yeah.
The memory fades, and all of a sudden the new temptation is there.
Yeah, and plus being greedy can be fun for a while, I guess. Leverage can be fun when it works. Yeah. Leverage is one of those things that works 99 times out of 100, and when it doesn't, it's all over.
How do you explain the fact that you always enjoyed making it more than even spending it? You enjoy making it and investing it, but not necessarily spending it.
Well, I have everything I want in life, so there's nothing to spend it on. I mean, I could have 10 houses instead of one. Would I be happier? No way. I could have 10 cars instead of, two in the house. I wouldn't be happier. It would drive me crazy. I could have a 400-foot boat, and then I'd have a crew of 50 or 60, and some of them be stealing from me, and some of them be sleeping together. I mean, who knows what would be going on? So I don't. If I wanted to be a ship's captain, I'd go into different professions. So I have everything in life I want.
And what you enjoy doing is studying where we are and understanding, trying to do the kind of analysis through conversations and reading and figuring out.
I love working with the people I work with. I love just viewing the human scene, but I mean, I have an ideal life. I get to do what I want to do every day. So, and money can't buy any more than that.
What do you think of value-added tax?
Well, I basically don't like it because it's somewhat akin. It isn't the same, but it's somewhat akin to a sales tax. Yeah. I mean, it's
regressive.
Yeah, it's regressive, and we don't need more regressive taxes in the United States.
That's why you don't like cap and trade.
Yeah, well, that's right. In terms of the way it falls on people, yeah, absolutely. I think that we're looking for more money. We ought to look to guys like me. I mean, I am still paying a lower rate on dividends and capital gains than my cleaning lady is, in terms of her payroll tax, just to start with. And so I just think that we've gotten so far out of whack in terms of who's been prosperous in recent years. And most of the economy, most people have been left behind, So we learned that a rising tide lifts all yachts.
But there are not a lot of guys like you to start with.
Well, there are some.
You're the top of the list there with you and Bill. But there is also this. What is an appropriate rate of taxation of people like you before, as some conservatives and supply-siders argue, you began to somehow inhibit growth?
Yeah. Well, I worked through all kinds of systems of taxation.
Right.
And I worked with rich people, even in the 50s, but in the 60s. And I worked with them when the top rate was 70%. I worked with them when capital gains rates were 39.6%. And not one of them said, it's 1 o'clock, instead of working this afternoon, I think I'll go to the movies because my marginal rate is so high. I mean, if anything, they worked harder, Charlie.
Reason they got rich is because they worked hard.
One person. I had hundreds of people, in the partnership, and not one of them ever came to me and said, Warren, I've decided to hell with it. 39.6%, I'm not going to invest my money. What would they do with it? Stick it under mattresses?
Does that mean that the American system is, in a sense, a bit unfair and geared to the rich?
Well, I think it has become more geared to the rich as time has gone by, and I think that the rich have, obviously a disproportionate impact, on how Congress behaves. And no, it
you money have and, to money and politics.
You basically have to, if you have a very rich country with a great number of super rich, you have to fight against a plutocracy. I mean, the Congress has to be your bulwark for the principles of democracy to win out over a plutocracy, and we've done that well in this country, but it's a constant fight. I mean, K Street is not populated by a whole bunch of people that represent my cleaning woman, if you look at the Forbes 400, you'll find that they find their way to K Street and it finds its way to them. Sure,
they have multiple voices on K Street.
Sure, they care.
So what would you do about that?
Well, it's always a problem. And you want a prosperous country, so you want a whole bunch of rich people. But you also want everybody to do reasonably well in something as prosperous as we have. We have $45,000 of GDP per capita in the United States. Yeah. But we've got almost 60 million people living in households where the top income is 21,000 or less. That's the top of the 60 million people. So we can do better. Now, we have done better over time. I mean, we put in Social Security, and we've done things in the country that have worked in the direction.
Medicare, Medicaid.
Yeah. But a prosperous country should not just be prosperous for the people like me who are wired in a particular way at birth, no credit to me, but I happen to know something about capital allocation. It wasn't, you know, I could have, instead I could have been wired, you know, so I was, I don't know, a great ukulele player. but there's more money in
sometimes you can be both.
But. Yeah, well, not often. Not in this case, anyway. But there's more money in what I do. And you don't want to mess up the market system that works to bring out of people what their best talents are. But the market system is not perfect in any kind of distribution of wealth. And taxation is a way where you get to the excesses of what the market system produces and where you take care of the people that get the short straws. In a country as prosperous as we are, nobody should get a really short straw.
You know, some people are going to hear you say that and they're going to say, Warren's talking about sharing the wealth. There he goes.
Yeah, well, I'm talking about sharing the prosperity. There's no question about that. I am prosperous because of the society around me. Stick me down in some poor country, and I'll walk around saying, I allocate capital. You know? And they'll say, so what? No, you know, what we need is a guy with a strong back. You know, and I don't have a strong back.
Can you row a boat or something?
Yeah, do something like that. So society, listen, when a couple of middleweights fight it out on pay-per-view this weekend, you know, and get $49.95 from me or whatever it may be, and I can't remember their name 2 weeks later, you know, they are benefiting not because of their own talent that much, but because some guy invented television and then invented cable television and learned how to change a stadium of 15,000 people into a stadium of 300 million. So they benefit from society. We all do. And some like me benefit enormously from society. You know, I can't do it by myself. Stick me on a desert island, you know, and you do not want to be on that same island.
There is this also. The Bush administration says that when the economic crisis came, they treated it with a tactic, which was doing what they did. They worry that what the Obama administration is doing is a strategy to put in place a different attitude about the relationship between the government and the economy.
Yeah, I don't think the Obama administration wants the government to take over the economy, but they did. They took on a situation. And incidentally, I give credit to the Bush administration in that last 4 or 5 months of 2008. I mean, a lot of right things were done. I mean, when George Bush said, you know, if money doesn't ease up, this sucker can go down. Now, that was one of the most profound economic statements ever made. Yeah, I mean, he became the economist in chief as far as I was concerned at that point. But so I give them credit, too. But the Obama administration, they're not running General Motors because they want to run General Motors. I mean, it isn't like that Barack Obama group was a great itch to run the whole American economy. They're doing what?
Oh, he might want to buy a railroad, though. That's said to be a fun
game. Can't buy it from me.
But go ahead. It's a good point.
But they are doing what is necessary in their view to get this economy righted. And like, nobody makes perfect decisions on this. And they're doing things I'm sure they don't like to do. I don't think they want to run General Motors, you know, or Chrysler or anything of the sort.
Or own AIG.
Or
AIG.
That is no fun. Or prop up Freddie and Fannie and all that sort of
thing. These people who think that somehow there's some new idea about, and they use the word socialism, but something else in terms of,
Barack Obama wants a much more prosperous economy, embodying the principles that have made it prosperous. But I think he does want to make sure that the bottom 20 or 30% does better than it's done in the last 20 years while the top has prospered so much.
That brings us to the question beyond whether Congress has the will or not. There is this idea, which is how do you create a new regulatory platform and architecture? And you've got, on the one hand, the administration comes in and says, let the Federal Reserve do it. Then you have Chris Dodd says, no, don't do that. And then Barney Frank says, I'm somewhere halfway in between. Where is Warren Buffett?
I am 100% for the independence of the Fed.
Right.
I mean, if you have a central bank that is bowing to the will of Congress, either directly or indirectly through some of various mechanisms, it would be a disaster.
Wants to be in on their monetary decisions or oversight or whatever.
You got to hope you've got a good Fed chairman and some good members. But we've done that generally. If Paul Volcker was, you know, he was essential to this country coming out of that 1979-82 period, like we did. Ben Bernanke was essential keeping us from going into the abyss last September. We need an independent Fed, and I think every country needs an independent central bank.
But does that mean they should be the regulator as well?
Somebody has to regulate. And